and tried to recover some videos from a hard drive.
I'll delete all the.
I was supposed to go with Rohit to see the lab, and I skipped it. So I thought maybe all the effort has gone waste. The time was gone, but I think
this Purnam
it's
has
on.
Always been on.
So we'll be talking about some problems in learning, workup, special situations in IPCL planning, some situations you get caught into, removal of epithelium, IPCL causing cataract, dealing with those cataracts. So those kind of stuff we'll be dealing with. Again, no commercial interest. I will skip this slide. We discussed this yesterday. Statistical analysis, numbers speak. The more numbers you have, Edward de Bono says, there is always wisdom in numbers, and there's something called as a collective wisdom. So when you have any study, you have more numbers, there are more chances of you being right. So we approximately have nearly 1,200 IPCLs under the belt, or probably more for last 1 month, a few more added. More than 4 years of follow-up, 17 cases of piggyback, post-pseudophakic, so all this stuff I've discussed yesterday. One good thing is that the product has been used by nearly over 1,600 surgeons. So that's a huge number. More than 50,000 implants since 2013, and the product is still rearing go. So one thing which is proven, the track record is, it's a good product, it's stable, and most of all, it's easy to use. I'm doing a study for care group of, I'm not able to track all the patients. We've tracked 576 patients over the last 3 years. We just collected the first data of 300 patients. Can you just play this video? Rohit had asked me to show a video of detailed insertion over time, which I've evolved the methodology of doing the insertion. Okay, again, you need to keep these two holes on top. Some people use a plain BSS or your viscoelastic. I feel a viscoelastic in the cartridge makes the opening far more controlled and stabler. One method is, I did observe Dr. Reddy in the morning. He does not use any left-hand instrument. He just pushes the IPCL straight into the wound. Great if it works for him. But one caution for beginners is, as you push the IPCL inside and the eye rotates, a lot of times while going, it can hit tangentially the endothelium. So you need to maintain the XY axis by stabilizing one instrument into your side port. Once you've done this, make sure as you push, you are observing this hole. This hole should be coming on the left. I make two side ports, one side port always near the 6 o'clock. The reason is there are some occasional freak patients where for a beginner, you're not able to take out your viscoelastic properly. If you leave the viscoelastic, classically you'll see an IOP spike within 1 to 2 hours. So what this side port helps you is at 6 o'clock, just put the patient on slit lamp, use a 26 gauge needle, bevel facing downwards, put a drop of tropicacil, push the wound, I'll show you a video, you can do that, and the aqueous flows out. So in my practice, so many years, I don't have IOP spike, but all IPCL patients post-surgery wait in the VIP lounge for 1.5, 2 hours before they go, an NCT is done, and if IOP is fine, they're not sent back to my chamber. But if the pressure is even borderline high, they come to my chamber, I just burp the wound and send them back home. You notice that the lens has to open like this. In the earlier videos, some of the speakers were showing a lens was opening like this. Great if it works for them, but word of caution, that can touch the endothelium, the anterior capsular surface. And now there are different methodologies where you can enclavate this particular lens. This is one. The second one, I would try and go from the center. Now, one trick is, once your IPCL is inside the place, make sure that you rub both sides of the haptics to make sure that there's a complete unfolding. And once you've done that, you notice it did look that it has gone behind. I lifted the iris and I saw it had not unfolded. Could you just repeat that? Could you just go back a few seconds? Go back.
I think you wanted to do it here, but...
So you notice that. It looks as if the haptic has gone behind the iris, especially this one. But it has not. It had remained folded. So my experience, past experience has taught me, once it's done, I just sweep the iris and then I push the surface of the haptic once or twice like this, and after this time I've never had an irregular vault of IPCL. I did have four irregular vaults because I thought that the haptic has unfolded. Now this is what I'm talking about. Now it looks as if it's gone there. It had not unfolded. Could you catch it? It was not folded. It was still folded like this. So once this is done, make sure both sides you give a little rotation, 20 degree each side. This will make sure if there's any haptic which is stuck up somewhere in the iris or the crypt, it opens up. And then the moment you finish that, you'll actually see the lens settle down beautifully. Once this is done, the whole job is over. Next. Yeah, so different sizes I've used. I've gone till 14 millimeter plus, very small lenses also. So majority of the lenses were falling in within the range of 12.5 to 13.2. This is the subset which we have. Wall patterns, I'll show you some ASOCTs. Walls going till 1100 microns of vault, and the patient is doing absolutely fine. Especially with the new central hole, the vaulting is not causing any IOP, and the special design of the haptics is not causing any problems and even causing chafing or iris pigment dispersion. Whenever you have a very high vault, you should expect some pigment dispersion. But the beauty of the design of the lens is that even at just such a high vault, patients I'm monitoring for last 2 years, there is no pigment dispersion. Post-operative vision. Now, one thing I must say is the beauty of the lens is in the way it controls the astigmatism. Astigmatic control is amazing because actually I think you've taken one extra step which would cause problems for the surgeon out. That one step of secondary marking is taken off. So it increases the efficacy. Now, corneal marking, how do you mark the cornea? This is again a problem area. There are a lot of times, you know, you end up marking a bit of the conjunctiva. And when you mark that, there's a shift of 5 to 10 degrees here and there. The thickness of the pen marking, a lot of times there's a hesitancy. Now, these are problem areas. You mark with the pen and the patient moves and you mark again, then you have a thicker mark. And you have a mark itself which is 5 to 10 degrees. So these things will induce more problems. So you need to cut that too. I have mostly now started shift. I've shifted to, I use the gravity marker, the spirit markers, everything. Now I've shifted to a slit lamp marking in the OT itself. So suppose I have three IPCLs lined up. I just mark all three of them, ask them to keep their eyes closed, and one after the other I do them. So this is how it works. You can either put a graticule within the optic of the one of the eyes like you have in a LASIK machine. But what I do is I just align the slit lamp to a very thinnest beam, take it to maximum 13 millimeter slit size, first make it vertical and then take it 180 degrees. See it on the axis of the slit lamp, make sure patient's eye is straight, he's looking straight in the eye, then match the central reflex of the cornea on the reflection coming from the anterior capsular surface. And then the line should go straight. So two limbus, one center part of the line should fall in the straight line. It has never gone wrong. It is the easiest method which you can do. So this is how you mark it. And this is how you align the lens within the eye. Just two marks, 0-180, it is done. Excellent stability. Now, problem situations. Extreme myopia, minus 27 with minus 3. This is minus 15, minus 17. Brother and sister, twin brother, sister operated on the same day. Now, this is one of the cases. She developed retina detachment. Now, she developed retina detachment 2 years after the surgery. It had nothing to do with the IPCL, but this is one caveat. Whenever you're operating such high myopic patients, minus 30, minus 34, minus 29, what you need to do is keep them on regular follow-up. But what goes wrong is, problem area is, once you operated this patient, he's got 6-12, 6-9 vision. You are the last person he wants to see you. Believe me, I have so many patients corrected at such high powers, I have to force them, my telecallers need to tell them that we need to see your retina. And they cannot understand that because they are on cloud 9. They've never seen so clear. They'll go for parties. The girls will get married, go to their in-laws' house. And they probably never told their in-laws that they were minus 25 or minus 30. So there's a hesitancy. So this is another problem area. When you're operating high myopes, make sure You tell them that, okay, your refraction is corrected, but please be on follow-up. This girl had a retina detachment. I'll show you a video of that also. Now, this is the issues till now we needed to exchange. Four cataract reported. One was post-trauma. Patient was operated IPCL and he was playing tennis and a ball hit his eye and he got a cataract. There were three other explants due to bad sizing. I never blame the product or the machine for what goes wrong. I have to look within. So when I'm in the theater, my mantra says, Aham Brahmasmi. I am the creator of what happens in this theater. I don't blame the OT technician. He gives me a wrong instrument. I don't blame the OT technician. He gives me a wrong setting. That who am I? If something is going wrong, there's something which I need to do. The moment I take that responsibility, then the things flow from me. Rather than things flowing from downwards, upwards, they should flow from top to bottom. So these were, when we went back and he realized, they were bad sizing issues. The lens only will cause cataract if it is vaulting too low. High vault, we had bad oversizing till 11 microns. Now, repeated rotations, as I said yesterday, if your lens is rotating and it was okay within first 2-3 days, explant this. Don't try and re-rotate it. Am I right, Sanjay? Don't try and re-rotate it because you're just adding to the anger, anxiety of the patient. You take him into the operation theater, you'll rotate it again, he's going to come back to you after 2-3 weeks. I had a super VIP lawyer whose only job was to get money for clients in USA, some legal firm. And I had this issue. He was a sick gentleman. He had a rotation. I rotated the lens. He had a rotation again after 2 weeks. I rotated the lens. Then he went to Switzerland to fight some case. He came back after 1.5 months. I rotated the lens. And on that day, he said, Doc, I can sue you so that even to your 10 generations will be paying me money. And then he told me who he was. So that's one lesson learned. So when I went back, discussed with the company people, I realized if the lens is rotating in the first place, it will keep rotating. There is nothing you can do. Take this lens out. It's only that on the first visit you see post-op and the lens is rotated, take a chance of re-rotating it. But if the lens, the patient has acquired 6-6 vision and then mal-rotated, don't even take that chance. The best part, as I said, was the corrections of astigmatism. Extremely satisfied patient. So mainstay is your white to white and AC depth. Now points in workup as I always take a dilated refraction. Measure the size of pupil on a dilatation. None of the speakers has touched this. Whenever you're seeing the patient for the first time and you're doing your retina evaluation, please map the pupil. Because this is the dilatation you'll get in the theater. So in case you have a pupil which is not expanding below 6.5 millimeters, you're in for trouble. Because it's the worst thing to do, take the patient in the OT, open the lens, plan the surgery, and then struggle trying to put the lens, 11-12 millimeter lens, in a 6.5 millimeter. Of course you can do that, but you need to be beyond a particular skill set, beyond that learning curve to be able to do that. So in case this is a case which is not dilating properly, be careful. ACD is very, very important, white to white. Now vertical and horizontal white to white. None of us is talking about that. The moment you have a cylindric astigmatism, more than 2 diopters, I've seen, you need to take a vertical white-to-white also. Because the lens, if it's 6 millimeter wide, I'll just give you a logistic. There is some component of the corneal vertical axis and white-to-white also which has started coming into play. So it may give you an unexpected vault, too steep, too low. So make sure that you give the company a vertical white-to-white and a horizontal white-to-white so that they can play around with the angulation of the lens. Axial length, again, they want the axial length to know that the actual ratio of axial length to the anterior chamber depth. Gonioscopy. All the cases should have a gonioscopy before you do this procedure. Angle measurement and a specular count. White-to-white, most common referred, everybody keeps talking about the caliper, but at least in my hands, this only works as a confirmatory method. I can challenge anybody, at least I have seen, if I give you a caliper, you measure it, the same patient you measure it, the same patient I measure it, the difference can be up to 0.3. And anything beyond 0.2 is not acceptable. So what are we doing now? So what we do is we take 3 instruments and the caliper only uses to corroborate any 1 or 2 if there's a discrepancy. Because you need to have a baseline for the caliper to work. You cannot work on the caliper in the mid zone, because what you perceive as mid limbus, what he perceives as mid limbus, what my optometrist perceives as mid limbus could be totally different. In the same eye, you will have 7 readings. So it makes a great sense to use this as a backup system. Now, why I'm talking about this is, these are the problems I've gone through over the last so many years. Beautiful tool is, how many of us have an auto refractometer which measures the pupil? So this is one of your cheapest and most accurate tools. Believe me, most of my, out of all the centers I have, only 3 have Cirrus. Most of the centers have this. All my centers have this. So we've used this data in more than 500 patients. It is super accurate. 3 readings, take an average. I'll try and run a video. So what you do is, in these machines, you keep dilating these dots till they touch the pupil. So we switch off the lights in the OPD, take one measurement. So this is 4.9 millimeter. Next slide, please. Just a minute. Now this is a video. Could you just run this? Now this is what I call, you know, trying to be innovative. Because if you don't have a system, so here I will use the pupillometry and the white-to-white using a simple 1.8 lakh or 2 lakh machine. Super accurate. So see, I'm moving this line. There, one line is moved. You just come and touch, get it near the edge of the pupil. So right now I'm doing pupillometry. If you can see, it's a dark room. There. You have 4.8 millimeter approximately. And this is just using a simple ARK machine. Take 3 readings, or have your optometrist change the optometrist. What we do is, we have 2 sheets. We'll show you the worksheet also. One optometrist puts his reading and he puts it into the file. The next optometrist does the same thing and puts his reading in the file, so that they can't in the end say, sir, mera bhi ye reading aaya. Both the reading sheets come to me in my OPD. And 99% of times with this thing, they get the same reading. So, in fact, so much so in my Cirrus, I get a different reading, because how many of us are using Cirrus to do white to white? You'll notice there is a thing called edit mode, where you can go and edit the limbus in the white to end of the pupil. You do it 3 times, reading will vary. 0.18, 0.22, 0.16. But this nearly comes the same, because one thing is, there are no decimals. It's not 4.83, it's always 4.8. So your confidence level goes up. Next. Okay, pupillometry again, you can use that method, or you can use a dynamic pupillometry. Now here is a classical example. This is a patient who's got a scotopic pupil of 6.75 and mesopic of 3. How to measure the anterior chamber depth? AC depth works with most of the machines, it's very accurate. You can use a pentacam, you can use an ob scan, you can use a Cirrus. In some centers, I use my OCT OptoView to give me the thickness of pachymetry, and an AccuScan by Alcon to give me the axial length. You subtract it, nearly is the same. We did a study of 80 patients, you get a nearly super accurate value. So these are all innovations and jugaad, which if you have centers where you can't put all the equipment, so your basic workup is done. So if I have anything more than 2.8 or 2.9 by that method, this patient is automatically okay. But if this machine, even in the preliminary stage, is going 2.6, we don't talk about him to IPCL for IPCL at all. We don't even send him to the other center to do a pentacam or Cirrus, because at the first level he's rejected. Pearls of white to white is always evaluate the discrepancies between different machines. Over time, you'll get a hang which machine works best for you in your hands on your. Whenever there is a variance of more than 0.2 millimeter between both eyes white to white or the pupil size, recheck again. Recheck again. And if it is the difference, please mention when you're giving an order for manufacturing of the IPCL, that there is a confirmed difference of white to white. Otherwise, sometimes poor Sanjay has to take an average, and then you can be landing in trouble. Digital methodology. Now, anything, if you're using a large sized IPCL, as I said yesterday, go in for a smaller size IPCL, which means, suppose you're using a 7.5 or an 8 millimeter. I don't think they're supplying 8 millimeter right now, but on order, I think it can be made. I would only recommend you to use large size IPCLs once you've got a little bit hang of it. But if you're going for a large pupil size IPCL, then you aim for not for a 1.25 millimeter larger than your white to white, aim for 0.75 to 1. Because the welding patterns, the nomogram is gets totally different. Again, as I said, the same thing. Exception is larger, if the optic size is larger, aim for 0.75 millimeter larger size. Vault, we all know. What to do if, now this is the kind of worksheet which happens. You see, white to white, axis machine, caliper, obscan, cirrus, three machines, you have readings. And then you take an average. Now you can do a slit lamp examination to do a phakic-aisle vault, or you can ASOCT. Now this is a patient with a very high vault. You can see that. Can you see the lens is trying to come out? Now this is a patient where one of the haptics was not folded out. It didn't fold out totally, so it was semi-folded. And I was getting an irregular vault on the OCT. And I kept doing the OCT, ASOCT again, and it was always like this. I couldn't figure out what's wrong. So I called up Sanjay and we discussed. We couldn't figure out still. So I said, okay, I'll go to the OT, try and do something. So I want to show the video. I think if I have enough time, I'll show how I did it. So I just went into the OT, pushed some viscoelastic on top of the lens first. So it flattened out. The moment I washed the viscoelastic again from that area, it would tilt out. So that gave me an idea there's something local in this area. So what I did was I pushed some viscoelastic on top and went on the edge and just flushed out the loops. And suddenly the lens went in. So the same lens which are vaulting around 1100 to 1200 microns went to 650. Because the confirmation, so this is again a problem area. Can you play this video? This is a patient, you can actually see corneal haze. Patient in 2 hours, can you see the haze? Patient is sitting in the lounge for 2 hours. I called him back, could you play this video? So if you, I have one port here, one port on the left side. The IOP is high. Take the needle, bevel up. Just dip the wound and you'll see the fluid come out. There. Just slight dipping of the wound and the fluid comes out. You don't need to over drip it. Just maybe one drop or one and a half, 2 drops is good enough and the IOP suddenly comes down. And you'll notice that the cornea starts getting clear from the word go. There, the cornea started clearing up. Next slide, please. So these are problems you will face. When you do high volume cases, sometimes in a heavy OT, you might not remove viscoelastic completely. Again, you need to make sure that you have to add at least 8 millimeter of dilatation before you can plan a good, safe IPCL. Video, please. Now, the beauty of the V2 is it can come out of 2.8 millimeter incision. Video, please click. Now here this lens has been loaded wrongly. You see, the lens goes in. Midway I'll realize there's something wrong because this loop was supposed to be on the left side and it's on the right side. I'll try and balance it. Another thing which has gone wrong is this is the forehead of the patient. These two holes need to be under the eyebrow. So they're gone down. I'll try and set it right. I had two options. Now since the lens is opened up, either I could have rotated it on top of the iris and put it in, but what it does is it irritates the iris. By the time you're through, the iris will shut down on you. So the best thing is, in the same go, see how beautifully the lens comes out. That is the beauty of this material. No stretching, and you put the same lens back in. There's no scratch, no stretch marks, no cracking. So my tip is, in case you wrongly loaded the lens, please don't rotate it on top of the iris and never, ever, ever on the lens surface. Then you're surely going to have a cataract. But if you rotate it on the iris, by the time you're halfway through 40 to 50 degrees, you'll suddenly feel that the iris has started closing now and now you're in a fix. You have the IPCL inside the eye. Even if you explant it out, at least in this sitting, you're not going to put it. My partner Samir had one situation like this. He dialed it. I would use another center. He dialed. The pupil went small. This was a Kashmiri lady. And then I get a call from another center. Ki Kamal, please come and help because the patient is on the table. Kashmir se aaya and they have to go back. He didn't tell me this. Rotated the lens 2-3 times. So when I reached the theater, the pupil is 4 millimeters. The lens is sitting on top of the iris. There is no way I can push this lens in. So we had to explant this lens, waste this lens, because I will be now operating this patient maybe after a day or two. This lens is wasted, the visit is wasted. So please don't try that. In case the lens is open wrong side, just pull it out and put it in again. It's a very, very safe procedure. Now this is that lady who got a retina detachment with silicone oil and she developed a cataract. Could you play this? Now what I tried here was, this was the V1. We all have explanted the lenses and done the cataract. I've done three cases with removed the cataract without removing the IPCL. The IPCL sits on top, I go underneath it and I do the surgery. So the trick is, push some viscoelastic to coat the endothelium, then push viscoelastic in the central arch of the IPCL to lift it in the center. Now the whole cataract surgery will be done. Could you just forward it slightly? Just get it till here. Yeah, here. There, I'm doing rexes under the IPCL. The IPCL is very much in its place. Viscoelastic is on top of the iris, IPCL and under. So I've done the capsular rexes. Now I will do a hydro procedure under the IPCL. Now somebody will ask me, why didn't you remove it in the first place? Now remember, this is the V2, a V1. V1 needs a larger wound to come out, which means I would need to expand my wound to 3 to 3.2 to get the V1 out, because it was a much rigid lens. Now once that comes out and I start doing my cataract surgery, patient has already got a vitrectomized eye, larger wound, lower scleral rigidity, floppy iris, such a high myopia, she was minus 30. I will be struggling. Or I would have to make a new wound, suture this and go to a new wound. So this is one technique which I employed. Just forward it slightly. Just go further. More. Yeah, there. So the IPCL is still in place. I'm under the IPCL. So I've created two planes. One is viscoelastic on top, IPCL underneath, and me under the IPCL. This is another video. The patient has symphony. Could you just play this? Patient at Symphony, operated in Chandigarh by one of our very good friends, Gaurav. Patient had plus 4.5 diopters, residual power. Came to me, she said, I've been told by the previous surgeon, he'll explant the lens, but I've read Google. Ek to Google ne bada jaan le rakha hamara. She said, I've read on Google and these are the complications of this thing, I don't want something. So I said, why have you come to me? She says, I saw some of your videos of piggybacking. So she says, I read about piggyback, so can you do a piggyback for me? So who's my Spider-Man? I called Sanjay Agal. So we take the white to white, we take the ACD measurement. The ACD was huge, 4.8 post-cataract surgery. So we design a lens with plus 4.5, specific white to white. Could you just forward? This is interesting. Just forward it. No, you've gone back. Yeah, okay, you do it. Just come midway. More. Yeah, this. So I just put the IPCL in on top of the previous lens. Patient super happy. Guess what? She gets a second eye done from me with a multifocal with the lens of my choice, not Symphony. So I put a tri-diff in the second eye. Now she says, Dr. Kapoor, this tri-diff is far better. So this is what, so I push the lens on top of this. This is a little tricky to put in. The dynamics and vectors of putting this lens on top of another lens are a little tricky, but it works. And once it goes in, it sits in like a baby. So without explanting the lens, without changing the corneal surface, doing a LASIK, you can just implant the lead lens on the top. Yeah, again, next one. Just play this video. Yeah. So I've got some problem situations where I'm trying to... Now this is a patient operated by me 17 years ago when he was a little kid for cataract. He just forward this slightly. Now he comes to me with minus 17 residual refractive error. Lens with capsular fibrosis, posterior sinicae, decentered pupil, minus 17. And you can imagine, 17 years ago, this surgery was done and I'd put a silicone lens called soft port. It used to be Bausch & Lomb lens. And the haptics, once you get stuck, there's no way they're coming out. Now, what do I plan here? Good old friend Sanjay to rescue again. We design an IPCL specially for this patient. Now, I will cut the fibrotic membrane. Just let's skip it. just come slightly
Kamal,
here.
Kamal, you have one more minute to finish.
Huh? Okay. So these are real problems, you know. The topic was problems. Okay. Okay, so I just free up, I use the micro scissors, I break the adhesions, and I just come here, somewhere near the hair, and we'll finish this video. So there the IPCL is inside the eye. This is a toric IPCL with minus 17. The patient was 6'12".
Same sitting you have done?
Yes, everything same sitting. You saw me do the, and this is a traumatic cataract. If you see, there's a corneal scar here. Can you see the scar which I had sutured? He came with a perforating injury 17 years ago. You see, we all work from the space we come from. There are so many times when me and Maipal get into a debate that I shouldn't have done topical in that case, surgery or whatever. Next, please. Now, this is the same case, though you can see the edge, I've dilated this patient. This is the same patient post-operatively. Now, another thing is, whenever you see a patient with a haze post-IPCL, don't think it's a cataract. Don't think it's a cataract. It could be a retained viscoelastic. Now, classical thing is, if you see, the viscoelastic has started thinning out. If you actually see, this is second day post-op, and my optometrist says, sir, cataract ho gaya. So I said, ASOCT karo. ASOCT was 650 microns. So then he says, sir, surgery kis samay touch ho gaya hoga. I said, wait and watch. Even agar chhota sa trauma hai, we'll see the cataract will increase. Fourth day onwards, you can start seeing that the opacity started thinning out. 2 weeks, totally gone. So don't be in a hurry to remove it. Always do an ASOCT. If it is a cataract, you'll see a white patch on the anterior capsular margin. If it's not a cataract and a viscoelastic retained, ASOCT will show something on top of the capsular margin. Again, this is a cataract. This is a cataract. We waited for 2 weeks plus. It was increasing, so we removed this. Now, we were talking about AC depths. I've got 168 micron AC depth with a V2. Patient still doing fine. This is 297. Now, this is a patient, again, as I showed, this has got something bulging out here. You can see it's an asymmetric vault. It's going like this. 1008. Thank you.
Wonderful. Kamal, I think very, very comprehensive and nicely covered. You've really touched all the very, very important points that go into using phakic lenses, and I'm sure everybody in the audience is going to agree. And some innovative uses of the IPCL. And, you know, I think we all have that big advantage that Care Group is so, you know, forthcoming to help you innovate and come out with
absolutely,
you know, solutions to all these problems. One quick question for you. Just like in that patient where you, over the symphony, you put in this thing, your
plus 4.5.
Now, have you seen, how many cases would you have done of a piggyback with the IPCL?
Around 17.
Okay. Any problem seen with any of those patients? I mean, interface haze or whatever.
Nothing, all that goes
with piggybacks.
Nothing.
Decentration.
The best part is, the biggest worry should be that you're putting two lenses. Now, a lot, Sanjay also keeps asking me, sir, why don't you put the add-on lens? Mm-hmm. You know, there's an add-on lens. I have some videos, but I'm not showing them. Add-on lens is far more thicker. Mm-hmm. So suppose I have a capsular fibrosis. The capsular has already shrunk. The iris diaphragm after some time, long time of the cataract starts going down. In those situations, I would not use an add-on lens. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, add-on is a far cheaper option than an IPCL. IPCL I use very safely because it's just an 80 micron thing which is going to go inside an eye, and as far the AC depth is beyond 4-4.5 millimeters. So AC depth is last of your worries. You just measure the white to white and go ahead.
Does the vault make a difference in a piggyback over a pseudophakic?
Yes. The vault is higher in these cases.
That's what I'm asking.
The vault is higher. The vault is definitely 750 plus in most of the cases where you do a secondary piggyback.
So anyway, you're not going to worry about causing a cataract.
Absolutely.
But does it make a difference to the refractive power of the lens?
No.
Like the IPCL, what is the ideal vault of an IPCL over a pseudophakic?
600, but it doesn't make a difference. It doesn't. I have patients with 1100, 1200 microns vault, but they're absolutely doing fine. They're doing absolutely fine.
No, because the A constant will change.
More than the A constant, it is the material thinness. The thicker it is, then the wall will start making difference. So that's one plus point which Sanjay unwittingly or knowingly has introduced into the system by making the lens thick. So the optics is so thin that the fluctuation inside the anterior chamber depth does not make change, much changes.
Is it possible to make a multifocal IPCL over a, you know,
I have done.
So that's what I was asking, like how, what designs are possible on multifocality? Like suppose you have a monofocal.
You have a trifocal lens. It works. I told you I've operated my OT technician. I operated my OT technician over a monofocal lens, which was.
So any questions from the audience? Anybody would like to ask anything, or should we break for lunch? Because lunch has been around for quite some time now.
Thank you.
But more importantly, you have told about that post-op RD cases. I mean, this type of, you know, pre-op assessment of retina is very important.
No, of course, sir, we do retina. This girl had a barrage done. She had a horseshoe tear. One, the other eye, she had a lattice with a hole. It was done a barrage. She only came for follow-up after 6 months. Then she was in her own world.
Most of time, because of IPCL, the RD is.
Yes, of course. The parents knew that, because if it's something is happening after 2 years, and then once she came RD with this eye, we screened the other eye. The other eye was subretinal, subclinical RD sitting out there. So my retina team did whatever they needed to do. Absolutely.
So that viscoelastic that you showed, I had a similar case right from the first few cases that I did, and that never went off. You know, and of course I knew it's not a cataract, and I knew it's retained viscoelastic because the hole never used Absolutely. To be there at that time. But you know, in 6 months it never cleared up, and I lost the patient to follow up after six months.
No, but did you do an ASOCT? ASOCT?
See, this was about 3-4 years back.
Okay.
Okay. Right, the patient is
because if the ASOCT is showing something on the anterior capsule, then only it's viscoelastic.
So see, I could make out it's retained viscoelastic because we went back.
One very interesting thing is, even if it's a very subclinical cataract, these patients don't know. They are doing very well at 6-9 parts
also. This patient of mine had poor quality vision post-op because of this slight haze, but it wasn't a cataract because I could make out it's in the interface, it's not a cataract. Yeah. Anyway, so thank you so much, Kamal, for that wonderful, elaborate lecture on IPCL.
Sir, one thing I want to add here to you. Whatever you want, we can provide for the patient. So, once patient comes to you, and before saying no to patient, please send all details to us.
Great.
And we will customize for everything.
Sanjay is always there to help out. I think that's one great quality. Thank you so much.
Kind of query, then you are just, we are very thankful that you are giving us every kind of lens. We have done a lot of cases. Which we are initially thinking we're not able to do, but thanks a lot, Care Group, for providing the lens.
Thanks, sir. Thanks a lot. My pleasure.